next month our secretary's report, but we'll now have the treasurer's report.
Balance carried over from previous month, $4,417.90. The receipts, total income for the month, $41,668.48. Some of that was from capital campaign. And the expenditures for the month were $39,700.02. $20,000 was the payment on the loan. And the balance carried forward in the now checking, $6,386.36.
Okay, are there any questions on the treasurer's report? If not, that stands as read. Thank you. Are there any committee reports? Any old business? Under new business, our next meeting on November 6th will be another oral history night. We're going to have oral history after we have our what's it part of tonight. Anyway, next time is another oral history night with the topic being Louise Dickinson Rich's work. And anyone having any personal contact with Mrs. Rich is urged to participate in this panel discussion. And I guess they would let you know, Stan, if they'd like to do that. Stan thinks that you might, that you should have volunteered. He might even take it on himself to get a hold of you.
We have only 7 recruits already, so on the panel, so we should be all right. Is there anybody else out there? We'd like to have them all. So.
Yeah. Okay. The artifact of the month, which I'll, maybe I won't. Hold up here, is the folding chair used by Bethel native General Cuvier Grover in the Civil War. And this was a gift of John and Fumi Head. Here is, for those of you who want to look at it during refreshments, picture of General Cuvier Grover, and also Civil War general, and also a list of all of his Civil War service. So I'm going to leave that available on the chair for anybody to look at during our refreshment hour, refreshment period. Another announcement is, call your attention and a special pre-publication offer on Randy Bennett's new book, The Mount Zircon Moontide Spring. I think a lot of you have seen a little evidence of the Mount Zircon company, the bottle, so-called, that was played up in the newspaper. Anyway, it's an illustrated history that will be coming out, and sheets allowing people or inviting people to sign up for the pre-publication offer will be over here on, right over here on the end. Another announcement that you probably saw in the Bethel Citizen this week is the public forum for Bethel residents that will be taking place next Tuesday evening, 7 till 8:30 at Crescent Park Cafeteria. It's something that the Bethel Comprehensive Plan Committee needs all of you, Bethel residents at least, to attend and give your opinion on what you'd like to see the town get involved in as far as planning Bethel's future. And a perfect example would be, what do you think the town might do more than they are doing to protect the historical district and other historical features of the town? So anybody who thinks, yeah, we'd like to see the town do more along those lines can say so at the forum, and it could work itself into a written town policy. On the other hand, to be fair, there may be some of you that don't think the town should get involved in anybody's property, and that would be the time to state that opinion too. In any case, the Comprehensive Plan Committee, of which I'm one, doesn't want to feel that us, or we 15 people, are trying to speak for the town. We want you all to get out and speak your own piece. Next Tuesday night at 7 at the Crescent Park Cafeteria. Okay, I think I covered all the announcements, Evan and I, Stan. So now it's time for What's It Night. And maybe some of you have already looked across here at the various artifacts. I'm going to hold them up, and if you can see them well enough to make an opinion, I'll let you speak right now. If it's kind of small,
just not, well,
start some around.
One on the floor here, we
ought to look at first, because it's sort of down on the floor. It's sort of a dangerous weapon.
See that one?
Round this up.
So what do you think, everybody? What is it?
That's a water key. Turn off the water.
No?
No?
That was an auger for...
Like a hole digger?
What's that?
They went down the center of a pine wall, and that reamed the hole, and then they went a larger one. You haven't got the whole thing.
No, that's right.
And they just reamed those holes, and that's what they had for a pump.
A pipe, right?
And they made for, they put their own hand pump handle on the side. You see them?
Yeah, it's also for...
They were square and narrow.
Also for water pipe, wasn't it, John? Making water pipe?
They made water pipe the same way.
Yeah, yeah.
There's a man over in Chatham that has the whole business. I don't remember the name.
Yes?
That would fall right through the pit of the log. That would stay right in the center of the log.
Okay, great. Now, you got batting 1,000 so far, but now we got another one here. I hope, well, somebody knows the real answer, I sure don't.
Tom Burris, when he raised asparagus, used to have them, he bunched asparagus, and on the end of the notch is where he trimmed the asparagus off on the end. He could put about a pound of asparagus in that. It had one for them, the heads of it up against the head. Tom Burris, who stood out on the flat.
Laid down.
Any other...
It laid down flat on the table.
Like this?
Yeah, like that.
All right.
Then you put your asparagus in, he could trim the end of it so they'd be even.
Okay.
He could put that raffia.
Is this would be the, where the blade, where the knife came down, you mean?
Yeah, then the butt end of the asparagus.
Okay. Sounds logical. Anybody got any other?
The cutaway place in there was for his hand, where he held his, so he could get his hand all the way around.
Like that?
Yeah.
You screwed it, okay. Terrific.
Simple.
Yeah. Crude, but effective. All right, very good. Now, while I still have my strength here, this heavy thing. What does it say on the top? It just says when it was patented. And October 28th, 84. So that's 1880, December 4th, 83, and October 28th, 84. June 85, and November probably 86. So here it is. Let's see now. You put something in the top, presumably. Maybe I'm going to have to pass this around, or has somebody already got an idea? Let's see.
It fastens down?
Plant seeds, you mean?
Something fastens down.
Well, that looks like it could be, because there's something kind of a paddle in the middle that would jiggle the seeds around when you go like that, so that it wouldn't clog. I don't know if you can see inside or not.
Does it get fastened down, Walter?
Pardon?
Fastened down, you've got by your left hand down below there, you've got some kind of screw or bolt or something, four of them. So it fastens somewhere or other. Halfway up, Walter.
Yeah, I don't know what that thing does. Yeah, it does go on to something else, like, I don't know, wheels maybe or something like that.
Somebody just said it's not all there, so...
No, it isn't all there, because you can see that these bolts are supposed to...
Neither
are. Are you people in the back able to see anything, by the way, or should I let you pass it around? No, you can see it okay? Okay, we got a seed planter. That's the first boat here. And this jiggles a little paddle in the middle so it doesn't clog up. It keeps the flow coming through a hole. There's a hole about that big in the bottom of this thing. What's that?
I think Rodney has the answer. That paddle on the side, when the wheels come around, it gets out of the seat.
Give it a little jiggle and Okay.
Just open it up to drop a seed, that's all.
Well, there has to be, there's something more that's come off it then, because the, doesn't do anything the way it does. Okay, a seed planter with something that jiggles a little boost or something. All right. I figure we have no objections from the paid staff here. All right.
We're taking donations tonight too, by the way.
Well, I'll do it in order here, just so I don't get mixed up. This is, looks like it's ornamental and not functional. Hole in the bottom where it fastens on to something. So I guess the question is, what did it fasten on to?
That ever been brass plated or copper plated, or chrome, not copper, chrome plated?
Looks like it had some kind of a coating on it.
Looks like it might have been the top of a stove. Stove top and set on top.
But ornamental on a stove? Yep. Is that it? Like a living room, not a kitchen stove, but a living room stove that's symmetrical sort of. Okay, an ornament for the top of the stove. You don't think so?
I don't know. It's not a primitive, is it? Some sort.
No, I don't think so.
It's not the hole in it. It's a handle.
The hole in the box.
It's a finial,
but what for? And I think they're saying a stove, probably. All right. Now, we got a long rod with a little hook on the end. That sound right?
Which building? This is the pointer we use in every meeting. Local building is gone. Very famous building.
A very famous building that folks use.
The old grammar school.
The old great grammar school?
No.
No?
Down at the Gould Academy.
No, further away. No, the Gilead Congregational Church.
Oh.
Is that right?
Always used to open and close windows.
Where was the Gilead Congregational Church?
Right on Route 2, just beyond the picnic area, as you go towards Gorham.
Yeah.
There's a picnic area, and then the church stood right on that big, big hill, and we have a pointer, and we have two pews over in the barn.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Good. Well, I mean, the mystery is kind of gone on this one, but it is an old tool. Maybe it is, maybe you can still use it. Maybe it's still useful. Probably is. It says sharpens everything, but it hand cuts glass for your kitchen, sewing basket, and sportsman's kit.
On the back it tells you all sorts of things.
Oh yeah, sharpening knives, cutting glass, sharpening scissors and shears, sharpen lawnmowers, other tools. It does everything. Okay.
1940.
Okay, 1940. This looks interesting. I don't think it's a back scratcher, so I will rule that one out. You know, something that moves around. Like, I guess it's all here too, right? I mean, it's not. So maybe.
Pick up the fireplace log.
Yeah.
Could be something where once you get something in it, the weight holds it together. That type of a thing. This looks like it's for insulation, because this might get hot or something like that. I'm just guessing all this stuff, by the way. Oh, wait a minute, what does this thing do? Oh, okay, here we go, folks. You can twist this around like that.
Just to get merchandise off a store shelf.
Excuse me, what was that again?
To get merchandise off a store shelf.
Okay, like when they had the real high shelves, to reach up and grab a cereal box or something like that. That sounds pretty good. Anybody? anybody beat that explanation?
I thought it was to turn over log and.
That's right, that's what it was.
To turn over logs?
Yeah.
Okay, well, that's, that, maybe the fact that it's got like an insulated wooden would tie in with that, so. But you could actually use it for the other two. It's not that much different from gizmo that takes stuff off the shelves. Now, this thing is wooden except for what looks like a sharpening stone in the middle. It's a stone insert, a little bit rough. I don't know if somebody wants to take a look at it here. Looks like he's doing, it looks like it's designed so you hold it in both hands and sharpen something. So what are they sharpening? I guess that's the remaining question here. Something that you have to put a lot of beef into because you do it with two hands. At least that's my guess. Anybody think of what kind of a thing would be sharpened with this? The scythe we got over here as a, sounds logical. An axe? Okay, we got a scythe sharpener, axe sharpener, both so far. Mike is going to give another vote maybe, but nope. Anybody else want to?
Walter?
Yes.
Was it made concave in the middle, or has it been worn to the?
It looks to me like it's mostly worn in the middle.
Then it's something small that you're working on, isn't it?
About anything you'd use on
because
home?
It's just in the middle.
Okay, Stan, Randy, we want your vote here. We got to use the tiebreaker.
You don't know.
You don't know. His vote is we don't know. So.
I brought that in. I've had a lot of guesses just like we're having now. But yeah. The nearest thing that I can tell that it was. For sharpening scythe, I've had a lot of, the most everybody said that's all this false. And it went this way, and then this way, and this way. These ends were shaped that way so they'd slip in the pocket easy. I never see them usually, but
that's okay. Thank you, Ernest. You can keep that out there a while, and I'll move on to another one.
Came from an era where money was very scarce, and if you wanted anything, you either grew it or you made it. Well, my grandmother wanted a mustard jar, the worst way to put on the table, and there was no money to buy one. So one day when my grandfather wasn't too happy, he noticed she had an extra salt shaker that she never used. So he took that salt shaker out into his workshop. And you, if you want to look, you can see he cut the center out. Then he took a piece of tin and fastened it on for a cover. Then he took one of her clothespins and he whittled it down. It was in the day when men used to do a lot of whittling. And he whittled it down to make a little mustard jar. And he took it into her and she has mustard jar.
Special hand. Yeah, we do have that on video. That's just the kind of thing that would be preserved. All right, now. To me, it's just a puzzle, but anyway, here it is. Three pieces of wood. They're all joined together. So it's one of those things where you can't figure out how they got it that way unless you're an expert. Craftsman, carver, I guess. So I'm guessing. Well, no, you guess. Yeah, you're the. You think it's what?
I think it holds a bowl.
You think you set it down and.
Holds a bowl.
Yeah, we do have three getting it. These have three flat ends, like they sat down on something flat. And then these are rounded as if they held something like a bow. Let me see if I can make it work here. See, there it is. You must put something in it. I don't know if it makes a spark. Let me just start this around and you can see what you think. Nothing moves on this one. There's a little grooves here, flat on that, flat there, grooves here. Doesn't change position. So it's almost like a monkey wrench that doesn't, non-adjustable monkey wrench or something. Pipe wrench or bottle opener? Bottle, cap opener, you mean, or bottle opener? Small though, right, for that size. Too small for a jar opener or bottle opener, they say. No votes on this one?
Absolutely straight handle. That handle is straight all the way down through your hand.
Absolutely straight, yeah.
Round or square?
It's hexagonal, I think, or octagonal with a little flat, you know, flat side. Presumably for a better grip, so it doesn't twist around as much in your hand when you're
wrench.
That's wrench.
So either a square or a hexagonal nut or bolt could be twisted.
How about a cat's paws?
I don't know. I just. I would side with the back row there, though. To me, it looks like a wrench.
Square nuts.
I guess either. Hex nut, hex nut. Okay, a square or hex nut wrench. Anything that would, where the square or hex part would fit within that space, you could use it for. And if you had a bigger one, you had to have a bigger tool, I guess, because it's non-adjustable. Okay, how are we doing on those other little things, by the way? A ticket punch? All right. Like a railroad conductor used to use, or maybe they still do. I don't know what they do these days. Okay, a railroad ticket punch right here. And there was another one that was, maybe it's up in the back now, but we'll let that one continue to circulate. And we'll go back to witness and have to take apart again. Okay, this probably is broken. And something, which I haven't figured out yet, is 71 years old, made Mabel Bryant Clough had it when she was 10 years old and worked in the North Waterford yarn shop, I guess it is.
Pawn shop.
All right. But what is it? What is it?
You pull the leather out, you put that on your finger. Just pull out on the leather.
This one?
It makes a loop.
Oh, yeah, right.
How do you put that on your finger?
Like this, you mean, or two fingers, or one finger?
Don't you think something?
Okay, like that?
Well, I think you've got it modern tied up.
All right, like that. Now what do I do with it once I got it?
There was a hot cone.
Hot cone.
Yeah, you're a kid, you have to go with a hot cone.
Or whatever to serve.
Okay, you could have fooled me, but this is a corn husking gizmo.
There's another one somewhere, Howard.
No, it's one finger, I guess. Yeah, hey, show us how it works now. Show us how it works, because I'm not getting the hang of it myself. Okay. So you just use one end at a time.
Put your hand up in the air.
So you, once you dull one end, then you work on the other end or something like that. Okay.
Emerson, hold it up.
Hold it up,
Emerson. Is it on your hand or something?
Oh,
all right.
Do it.
What does it do?
Rather than use your fingernails, you use this.
All right.
Very good.
All right.
Everybody see?
Yes.
All right, I gotta try to redeem myself.
What?
But this is gonna be it. That I redeem myself. Okay.
Somebody up front of me just said that's the worst safety net.
Flat on the other.
You
maybe a part to something for all I know. I don't know if it's the whole thing or a part to something.
Make a spark, and she wants to say
this is like
something
twisting.
That makes a spark down the end. That isn't there.
Anybody
yeah.
Got some ideas?
What,
he was Ernest, help us again.
I can't see it.
Just a small.
Not all that, I don't think, but I think there's
something went on the.
No, I think removing cock stopper. I think it was a handle across the end. This end screwed right into a cock stopper and pulled it up.
It was like a wine cork remover.
He stopped you from going in too deep.
Okay, we got a wine bottle cork remover. And no alternate suggestions so far. So he figures that this had a little bar or something that you twisted that came off. That sounds pretty good to me. Next time we'll make him bring a bottle of wine and demonstrate how it works.
Corks.
Okay.
Corks on a blanket.
Yeah. Shell cases too. What was the other shell cases?
Shell cases.
Oh, well, these are pretty. Okay, I think this is about the one I could have got by myself. An old-time wrench, which isn't too much different from what you could buy these days.
That would be great to take off the nuts of that handmade wheel and carton.
Okay, and it had enough leverage to, these days the things are about twice as long, but, okay, a car wheel nut remover, right? Okay. What was the first thing? Well, spark plugs and wheel lugs too. Okay. Now we got three other things. This is real small.
top of the jar, and it goes underneath the rubber, and the air comes down, and you catch a cover.
Okay.
Really?
Okay, this has got something that's kind of sharp there. What?
Well,
why
that's
is it?
Between the rubber and
the air.
Yeah. See, this is like a sharp edge right here, like a tapered sharp edge.
That's right.
Canning gun. Okay. See the little nice blade?
I can, every part. Yeah, and it would work very nicely. I use the point of a serrated knife, which some do.
Okay, here's another real old day, and it's another, this is the second one, and maybe I could have got by myself.
I can't pull
and,
the rubber.
It's, I don't know if it gives a date any place or not, but it's a real old planer.
Yeah.
Actually takes a real small blade, so what's the right name for something that takes a real small blade like this?
Rabbit.
Oh.
Rabbit planer? Okay, a rabbit planer. Anybody want to take a look at it, or can you see it okay? Well, we still got that little thing with a sharp blade on the ground. Where is the little, not a tongue and groove, but you mean a tongue and groove type thing?
Point.
Yeah, this guy here.
Okay, I thank everybody that brought in the artifacts, because this was a real good show tonight, I thought. So keep hunting over the next year in preparation for next year's Watson.
Just wanted to bring to your attention before we begin the oral history that we've just gotten in this new book, East of Indian Lives, 1832-1816. It closes with a chapter on Molly Orchid, the most up-to-date scholarship on Molly Orchid. It's a wonderful book, and we're selling it now in the store, so if anybody's interested in looking it over, I'll leave it here so you can take a look at it. We were planning just to have an oral history night, but Bill White came through with a little video which gives us some overview of this whole episode, and I thought it might be good to show that first, then go to our oral history and see how much of this tape people agree with or disagree with, and see how much it reflects what really happened. So I'll turn on the TV. I hope all can see it. It's going to be kind of tough here because we've got such a wide crowd here, but we'll see how it goes. And I'll want to get the lights ready. You want to get the lights so we can share that work? And it's supposed to be all programmed. Let's see if it works like it should.
On October 23rd, 1947, thousands of Mainers woke to a beautiful fall day, and none of them could be aware of the impending natural disaster that was about to change their lives forever.
What you're about to see will take you back 50 years to 2 weeks in October in 1947, and the most disastrous forest fire in modern history of the state. In interviews with people that were there and photographs from the time, you'll get a sense of the awesome power, destructive power of forest fires, because the memory of those 2 weeks are forever etched in the minds of those who saw it.
To the 27th, 1947, more than 200 forest fires raged throughout Maine, consuming nearly a quarter million acres of prime forests, and in some cases, wiping out entire towns. York, Oxford, and Hancock counties were especially hard hit. Several others throughout Maine were threatened. In many cases, fierce winds gusting up to 80 miles an hour drove these fires so rapidly that hundreds of homeowners escaped the massive flame fronts with only the clothes they were wearing. Generations of heirlooms and other prized possessions were lost forever. In 1947, fire officials on both the local and state levels had little ability to communicate with each other, complicating the situation. And no one was prepared for a disaster of this magnitude. Drought conditions existed as little or no rain fell during the 3 months leading into October. The weather for the entire forest fire season was unusual, going from one extreme to another. In early March, an abnormally warm period saw temperatures reaching into the high 80s, causing snow to melt quickly and disappear from fields and woods at about the same time. To those engaged in forest fire control, this was an ominous sign. However, the months of April through June were cold and wet. By mid-July, a complete reversal of weather and ground conditions took place and continued well into fall. During that period, 108 days passed without any appreciable rain. The dryness of the soil was reflected in the foliage, especially with hardwoods. The lack of moisture caused the leaves to dry and fall prematurely. Vegetation was bone dry, and Maine was ripe for burning. On October 23rd, all hell broke loose.
We never slept. Lived on coffee and cigarettes. Cushions.
Camp's mother was with us. She was 65 and she fought fire too.
But someone called and said, you've got to get out. We jumped into Montlake Ford, my cousins, and headed for Route 113, and got caught in the fire. The fire had crossed the road, and we were debating what to do, and turned around, it was in back of us, and I remember my cousin. He said, this old baby will go anywhere. So he backed it up and turned it around, and we went back around the mountain.
In Brownfield alone, 200 homes and businesses were destroyed. The community was gone. Sadly enough, Brownfield was not the exception. Many small towns were gutted by these conflagrations.
It was a very hot day, and knowing the fire was in progress, I was helping my mother make corn chowder to take to the fire line that evening. And at noon, they came and picked it up, told us that no problems, we would be safe, because it could never cross Shepherd's River. Well, then by mid-afternoon, they came through and told us we had 20 minutes. So we were totally unprepared.
The town of Newfield suffered too. In the Goose Rocks and Cape Porpoise district of Kennebunkport, more than 200 homes, most of them summer cottages, were destroyed as this fire burned its way to the Atlantic Ocean. In Hancock County, Bar Harbor, with its palatial summer homes and grand hotels, all sustained massive damage. Half of the landscape in this world-famous summer retreat was blackened.
There was a lot of leaves around and so forth, which is in the middle of October. And sparks were landing all around, but we're doing a pretty good job putting them out underneath the porches and things like that. And I happened to look up on top of the roof, this Malvin Hotel, which was huge, and the Belmont was right next door to it. And there was a little patch of fire, probably right, oh, so big, you know, right by the chimney. It was gone, just that quick, just that quick.
In Washington County, residents in the towns of Jonesboro, Machias, and surrounding communities had to be evacuated. More than 20,000 acres of timber and wildlands were burned. In a one-hour period on October 23rd, the fire traveled more than 6 miles.
I was up in North Waterville when he went across the road and burnt the board yard. And that was you've seen how board is stacked, you know, and that fire would hit them. It was almost like they would explode. That would take boards, 12-inch boards, 10, 12 feet long, right into the air, all the fire. You know, there was such a current from that. And I feel scared when you see something like that. If a train was going, if you laid in the track and the train went over, it wouldn't make any more noise.
In 1 week, 15 fires, each burned at least 5,000 acres. In many cases, families had only a few minutes to gather their belongings before leaving their homes for safer ground.
And Mary said, Doris, what do you want me to save? And I said, well, I like my piano, but I know you can't save it. Oh, yes, he said, we can put it in the dump truck. So it was on casters, and they wheeled it out and put it in the truck. The last time I saw Brownfield, when we got to the Wicker place, I looked back, and Brownfield was all ablaze.
The wind was blowing real, you know, almost like a hurricane. And of course, it was blowing all this fire along ahead of it, which was consequently standing more behind us. Just a hopeless situation.
On the evening of October 23rd, Governor Horace Hildreth declared a state of emergency. In a broadcast to the people of Maine, he requested all citizens give whatever help they could to the Forestry Department. The President of the United States, at the request of the governor and the Maine congressional delegation, also declared a state of emergency. The President's action immediately made available more assets, equipment, and tools from the Office of Civil Defense for all the fire areas. The Forestry Department asked for help from both the Army and Navy and got it. Soldiers provided much-needed equipment and additional manpower to help weary volunteer firefighters battle the fires. By month's end, nearly 36 Maine towns had sustained heavy losses. 9 were practically leveled, with property damage totaling nearly $70 million. Timber losses were estimated at $10 million. In today's terms, these losses would equal well over $3 billion. Hundreds of Mainers lost their jobs, as many businesses also were destroyed. 16 people lost their lives.
People just couldn't believe, you know, the devastation. It just, I think it humbled everybody. And that's why for years afterwards, and I think even today, there are enough of us alive that when we have a fire, you know, you gotta get to it, that's all.
When the last flames were contained, more than 2,500 people were left homeless.
You can't believe the noise. And I said, I've been overseas, and I think I was as scared during the fire as any time when I was over there at times. You know, you just figured that you weren't going to get out of it. You just figured there was nothing ever going to put this fire out. You know, you kind of began to get the feeling the whole state was going to burn. In fact, there wasn't much that stopped it until we got to the ocean.
I remember down behind my house there when I come up behind the field there, the fire probably was a quarter mile here up behind my house. The field there probably 8 acres in it, and the grass was this tall. I'd taken my John Deere tractor, all the neighbors, and I took plow and plowed a lot of furrow around, but you know, I didn't know nothing. But the field burst in flame just like you put 100 gallons of gasoline in it and threw a fire in it. I mean, you had to see it, believe it. I mean, just exploding the whole.
Throughout those two infamous weeks, hurricane force winds caused havoc for firefighters, making control efforts extremely dangerous and often impossible.
You could hear it coming. It was just like the sound, I can't describe it. Just very loud, just a roar. And we saw this sheet of flame, and it rolled just like this. Made one roll, just like you see water on the beach. And the house was gone. It exploded. And we turned to run because it wasn't a good place to be, and the hoses were steaming.
Firefighters frequently had to drop their equipment and run from flame fronts, reaching as high as 300 feet. The intense and erratic fire was unlike anything firefighters had seen before.
It was blowing. It was a funny feeling. The embers, the smoke, you would hear roaring, just like a freight train roaring. And then there'd be complete silence. Nothing. And it was eerie. And then it would start again.
Relief finally came for thousands of weary firefighters on November 8th, when rains fell over much of the state.
Several days afterwards, yes, longer after I'd gone back to work, I drove through the Eagle Lake Road out to the head of Stone Sound, and that was really just flat. And I can remember saying, I think the rocks burned too. Everything was so black and bare.
Throughout the ordeal, Mainers pitched in, neighbor helping neighbor.
Everybody helped, everybody helped. So never any place anywhere that had more people working together than we were here in town. It was wonderful.
The Red Cross and Civil Defense helped feed and temporarily house the homeless. Hundreds of steel buildings were brought in by the military to serve as homes, schools, and churches, some of which are still in use today. Never in Maine's history had so many people been affected by such a disaster, and never had so many people come to the aid of their fellow citizens.
You were speechless. There was nothing anywhere. And to get through the highway was something in itself. The trees were burned, the limbs were down. It was just an unmistakable mystery. But everybody else was in the same boat. Everybody pitched together. You were no worse off than your neighbor, and everybody was just together.
It takes something like that to find out how much you appreciate your neighbors and your relatives and that was good.
When the smoke settled, the damage was not unlike that of a massive bombing raid seen during World War II.
Just something that nobody ever believed could possibly ever happen to them. And it's like, I'm sure it happened in the war when you were in Europe or something like that, and you don't know, you're living in your little town, and then the first thing you know, it's all bombed out. And so what did they feel like then? What do they feel like now? And it's the same odd thing that we had to use here.
At times you didn't know whose houses it was. I mean, with so many gone, you didn't know where you were. Oh, I remember so well feeling so empty, so sick to my stomach, so scared. And my folks were just devastated.
As I remember driving through town, all you could see was cellar holes and chimneys. The chimneys were still standing, and it was still smoldering, and it was steel roofing, which was basically what most every house had, was steel roofing. Of course, that survived, and that was all rumble and mess. Quite devastating. Something that you don't forget right off. It's kind of burns in your memory.
Investigations into the causes of these fires revealed several sources, ranging from careless backyard debris burning to unattended campfires, and all too often, many of these fires were believed to be arson. As a result of these fires, forestry officials from the New England states and the provinces of Quebec and New Brunswick met and formed what is now called the Northeast Forest Fire Compact. Whenever fires or other natural disasters occur, its members provide mutual aid. This cooperative agreement was among the first of its kind in the nation. Shortly after the 1947 fire season, the Maine legislature established several forest fire prevention laws intended to lessen the chance of a repeat disaster. Strict open burning requirements were established, as well as tougher penalties for violators. Later, mechanized equipment operating in the forests of Maine were required to have spark arrestors installed on exhaust systems. Additional campsites were established where recreational fires could safely be built. An aggressive fire prevention program was established. In an effort to quickly spot forest fires, a network of aerial detection flights was begun. Today, Maine Forest Service Rangers and municipal firefighters are better prepared to deal with forest fires. Training has improved greatly over the past half century, and excellent cooperation exists among state, local, and federal fire organizations and landowners. Firefighting equipment also has improved, both on the ground and in the air. Today, excellent communication systems are in place, a far cry from the limited systems that existed in 1947. When fire strikes today, water bombing helicopters from the Maine Forest Service arrive quickly and in many cases can slow the spread of a forest fire until ground crews can establish control lines around the fire's perimeter. Newer forms of mechanized ground equipment have improved to aid firefighters as well. In general, both Forest Service and local fire department personnel are much better prepared when a forest fire breaks out. Could Maine ever experience another disastrous autumn like that of 1947? Forest rangers and other fire officials say the likelihood of a repeat disaster is not great. However, Mainers must not let their guard down and must always be prepared to make a rapid strike against all uncontrolled fires. Our state's economy is greatly dependent upon a healthy forest environment, and protecting our forests from fire should always remain a priority.
Volunteers, and this happened to be a Friday night, a Friday afternoon after school, so two or three of us decided we were going to walk down. It wasn't too far south of Freiburg, and we walked down to an area, there's a pond down there called Round Pond. I guess about every town has a round pond, but on the east side of the road as you were going south, there was a fire line burning off over a ridge. And it was mostly slash, there wasn't any tall timber or anything burning. And they wanted people to carry water from Round Pond over to the fire, which was maybe less than a quarter mile from the pond. So a few buddies and I volunteered to carry Indian pumps from the pond to the fire line. And this went on into the afternoon, late into the afternoon. And one of the things you heard in the film was the fact that they were lacking in experience. And that was very profoundly evident at this, in this situation. I don't know how many people were. I would guess probably 20 or 30 on the side of the ridge that I was working with. And as it got into the evening, this crew just began to disappear one after another. And we were carrying water up and down on my side of the ridge. They finally, up on the top of the ridge, they finally broke the fire line, separated it. And of course, as many of you know, in the evening, fires begin to settle down a little. And we were carrying water. And so the crew, at the top of the ridge, the crew divided. And one crew went down the other side, and the remainder of the crew on my side came back towards me. And we kept squirting water on the fire and so forth. And finally, we got it to the point where there were no visible flames on that side of the ridge. And pretty soon, eventually, it ended up with only myself and I think two or three other of my classmates. There were only two people or three people left on that side of the ridge. So we wandered around there and began getting dark. And every time we'd see a few coals flare up, we'd go and put water on them. And finally, it got pretty dark. And there was nothing visible that we could see on our side. But we could still see glow coming up over the other side of the ridge. So being ignorant little boys and didn't know anything about fire, we picked up our Indian pumps and loaded them up with all the water we were carrying, went over the ridge. And they were still working on the fire line down there. And again, they were had the same condition. There was no tall timber, they just slash. And so we helped them, we provided what water we had. And when we finally finished, ran out of water, we had no flames on that side either. We had a few glowing spots and they were going around mopping them up some good on them. And so finally, I got the chance to get out of there and find a way to get home. And at the time I left, we looked back over the ridge to the side where we had left, and there was this ominous orange glow in the sky. So I'm convinced that if they had had enough intelligence and training to realize what that fire would have done, that they could have totally controlled it that night. But this was probably the first or second night the fire burned, and that was the one that went on and burned Brownfield.
Thank you. Hi, what was your situation in 1947?
Well, I have a lot of stories, but just to give my situation, I was a junior at Bates College, and the president called the governor and said, we want to help, and the college furnished the transportation, and they hauled a bunch of volunteers from the college over into the Brownfield area in Keysa Falls. And I really don't remember how many days or how many nights we were there. It seemed like a long time. It was probably just a couple of days, a couple of nights. But I do remember some stories from that period, and our cuts from classes were excused, but when we got back, they said, well, you're still responsible for the work, so we didn't gain much. But I certainly remember the experiences of those few days over in that area much better than I would have had I been in class. I'll stop there, and I have some stories later.
Howard, what were you doing in 1947?
Well, it was sort of coincidence for me. I was in Bangor, and I went to
callous with a man from Bangor, called him Donald Grant, who ran a milk business there in Bangor. And we went to callous that afternoon. Actually, it was the day of our harbor burned. And we were, as we went down, we didn't realize there was anything of any great danger, or that we knew fires were around. And we went, attended a meeting there in Callis, and got ready to go back. We went into a restaurant to get a bite to eat, and they told us in there that the fire had spread to a lot of the very fine homes there in Bar Harbor. And Mr. Grant, that I was with, also had a dairy in Bar Harbor, and he was quite concerned because the fact that the fire was spreading around. So we left the restaurant and started for Bangor, and we went back to Bangor over the airline, and I'm sure many of you have been over. Back in those days, quite a bit of it was still gravel road, but it was a good passable road. And but it got dark, and we had seen smoke, and it was quite obvious it was quite a bad fire. But as we would get up onto these high points on the airline there, you could look over towards Bar Harbor and you could see a tremendous amount of not about smoke, but the fire flames. And but we weren't really privy to what exactly was going on. And so when we got back to Bangor, Mr. Grant wanted to go to down to see how his property was, and they told him he probably couldn't go down, but then he explained to them what the situation was. So they let him through, and I don't know if I went down with him. And I did. We got down there about, I think probably 2 o'clock in the morning. And but as you cross from Trenton across the causeway there and go on to the island, and start on the road going in, I don't know what the route number is, but on the road going into Bar Harbor, right off, it was very obvious you could see the remains of the beautiful homes that already burnt, and all you saw was foundations and chimneys. We got into Bar Harbor. The fire had not spread right into the town, which is an amazing thing that it didn't, because the fire came very, very close to the town. But we stayed there until probably around 5 o'clock in the morning. He found out that his property was all right, and we started back to Bangor. And I remember staying in the hotel there in Bangor, Bangor Exchange. I'm sure many of you people remember the old Penobscot Exchange there. But it was just by coincidence that I happened to be there, and I had nothing to do with fighting the fire. I was just observing actually what had happened, and it was really a tragic sight to see the, just a bit of stop my voice is leaving. But the fires were pretty well out when we left. However, you could still see smoke, but the homes were gone. It was tough. Thank you.
Emerson, what was your role?
Well, I was working in the woods out in Albany, there all having a Kimball plant there, my brother and I. When them fires broke out, we could smell the smoke real strong out there. But they, Bert Newton, one of the select men, and he asked us if we'd patrol nights from 6 at night till 12 o'clock, or 12 to 6 in the morning. They thought that there was activists around setting fires, and they told us carry guns. We did. And we used to ride down over the hill out back down the old road, some there, went down to come out down with Bob Anderson's there. And we'd patrol that for 6 hours, and then we'd go home, somebody else would take up. We used to meet out down there sometimes so that they'd know when we left that somebody else took over. Because they felt real sure that there was arsonists around. But I never did help fight any fire.
John, what was your role in 1947? What were you doing in this relation to the fire?
I didn't have much of a role, I guess. I was on the Freiburg fire, Freiburg Battlefield.
Yes.
And that was just two peat bogs burning, and they were just smoldering. And there was no the authority in those days, just the local town warden and the state were just helpers. And the town warden
eventually nature took care of it anyway. It was a high wind, you could hear it real strong, way high, and it just had to come down. When it came down, the fire from the time it broke out really got going. It came to the road where we were down the road by the brownfield. In 2 hours it was in brownfield. It had jumped, 30, 40 rod. And sometimes it jumped more, they said, down that way, right from over the top of the hill. It would go on to the knees of a mile. Fire itself put itself, just run out of fire after a while, actually. Very little that it was done. They went along beside the highway to try to keep it from going, but when it came to the highway, it crowned over and was gone. We had a little fire in all at the same time. One of the local boys heard all about the fire and thought he'd have one.
Definitely arson, wasn't it?
It was pocketed, fortunately.
I see.
We were all out the fire.
I see.
And because we got word of it, I called up Lowell to see how things were. And Mrs. Rookie, she was all in quite a titter. And she said, there's fire in North Lowell. Well, I lived down below North Lowell, way the wind blowing. So we went along getting back into London. When we got there, they had it all over. The wind didn't get hold of it. It was like in the kind of a pocket, just stayed up there.
I said, good, good. Ernest, what about you?
Well, I didn't have any role in fighting the fire, but there's a couple of things that I remember about it that kind of stick in my mind. I was working in Rumford, and what they call Moss's Garage, that's that building is gone now. It's where the Muskie building sits, or part of it sits in. And they sold a bag of automobiles, and real trucks, and Willis Jeep. And they used to have to pick the Willis, the real trucks up in somewhere south. I forget just where it was, but it might have been Boston or down at least somewhere. They brought it in what they call piggyback, one upon the other. And they wouldn't let them come in at night. They wouldn't let them drive through at night. But they'd bring them in during the day. They'd let them in through. The smoke was so thick that they would bring them in. And that was one of my jobs there, was to service those trucks and get them ready for customers. I tell you, I'll bet the smell of that smoke is still in those trucks today. We never could get it out. And the other thing, I had occasion about maybe a week after the fires were out to go to Baham. And of course, Jackson lab there, that was all burned. And as they said in the film there, all you could see was the chimneys and cellar holes. And of course, I was in Europe in the Second World War. And that's what it reminded me of, is a burned out town. And that's the only thing I could think of. All you could see was chimneys and burned everywhere you looked, everything was burned. Although Jackson Laboratory, there was, as I remember, it was part of some building like that, something like that. But you know, there's a guy here in the audience, I don't know why he isn't up here tonight. I think he could tell more about the fire than any of us. Bill White over there, I think he was working for the Forest Service at that time or soon after. And he's retired from it. I think he probably got it a lot more.
You provide us the film
tonight,
so.
I retired in this.
But I'm getting away from the fire. I want to tell you something about this fellow right here. In the winter of 1941, they'll put that down. The winter of 1941, I was going to my wife. We was married in the spring of 41. And that winter, I worked in Oxford. In a sawmill, it was just across the Norway line. There was a sawmill, hospital, pet hospital is right on the site of where the mill was at that time. And I was a young fella, and of course my wife lived in Rumford Point. I had an old 19
come in and prod me up once in a while. Come on, Andrew, get going. Come on, Andrew. That was a good many years ago, wasn't it, John?
Moving on to the question of some memories of the of the fires. Do you want to tell us some memories that you have, Emerson? You have used to break up some people that were in the midst of things. Did you sometimes on your routes? Did you?
No, we never had.
I thought you said you took care of somebody who was up there parking over the hill, and that was illegal at that time, wasn't it? During that period.
No, I wouldn't.
Well, someone reported to me that he was broken up in the middle of things and by this guy who wanted to, didn't tell him that parking was illegal this time because they wanted to
You got me mixed up with somebody else.
Okay. How about you, Howard? You got a story too?
Yeah.
One story I remember, we had an outfit that was sent up from the Brunswick Naval Air Station to help with the fires. And I think it was the first night we were there, but anyway, it was dark. And this Navy outfit was there, and the officer in charge, he was real polished and had his uniform and his coat on. It's quite cold. But he was asking this local farmer, you could see the fire across the valley coming over the mountain, and they were trying to contemplate how to handle this fire the next day. And this naval officer, talking to this local farmer, he said, is that pretty soft down there in the valley? The guy says, by God, I guess it's soft. Horse will sink clear to its belly in the springtime.
How about you, Howard? Anything that you have to say?
Well, I don't think, beyond what I've told you, I say I was only there for a very few hours, and it was just by coincidence that I made it and was down there, and but it was stood in my memory quite a while.
Right.
I'm sure it will.
Right. Lyle?
Well, a couple of things that came to mind. I was just a few days past my 17th birthday, and when I finally came off the fire that night around midnight, they took my name and address and number of hours and so forth, and they told me then that since I wasn't 18, they probably couldn't pay me. They never did. I don't know how many of you know how the distance between, well, the southern part of Freiburg and Chatham Center country, but next few days later, they called for more volunteers, and my father went down to fight the fire down in Brownfield, and I think he was gone 2 or 3 days, I guess, but the one thing that I remember, and this is up in Chatham on the farm, we could look out in the evening and see that orange glow in the sky for, I don't know, 6 or 7 days after the fire, and finally cut it down so you didn't see that glow at night.
How about you, John? You got any vivid memories of the fires?
And what?
Any vivid memories of the fire?
Well,
one of the
main things was that there was no cooperation between the fire company. There's no reason in the world for Brownfield to be bothered. But there was, I was chief at Lovell, and tried to get some fellows to go in to go around the those little bogs and make a fire trench. And they got on the road, and there was easily 300 or 400 men between the lower end of the pond. I can't tell you where it is, but anyway, it's third of the way down the Brownfield. And if you could get those men, even 50 men going around, those bogs dug around, the fire never got away. But there wasn't anybody to tell them. And they didn't know me from Adam, and they didn't know anybody else. And it was right after that Austin Wilkin had a meeting down there. We had all denied the Western Maine Firemen Association, which you may have heard of.
Right.
And the idea of that association was just to get
quite a few felt the same thing, that they was, just didn't know anybody and you didn't take on with name. And then we were, some of us were asked to get down and give a little talk to the hospital. And that's when they shipped the door and passed them on. But the state put a man in charge in case the local fellow wasn't doing it.
Say there were a lot of turf battles and I was...
Same thing happened down around Sanford, that fire that went way through.
Yeah.
There's some stories, I've read some on that, where the fellows were riding on with a tanker of some kind, and they'd put a fire out and go somewhere else. There was nobody to watch it, and they broke out again, and somebody else run around and put another fire out again.
Yeah.
No cooperation.
Right, I see. That's an interesting insight. Ernest, do you have any?
Well, not on the 575, but in, I think it was 1938, he had, must have been 38, because 38 when he had a big hurricane right down. Mm-hmm. But after the big hurricane, there was a fire started in almost in the Roxbury Farm. Once Mando took Roxbury Farm, they called up to help. And they get to the farm, but they got a bunch of us young folks into a flatbed truck and they took us from up and over there. By the time we got there, the fire was all out, they had it all out. And so then we went back home. But I was, like Lyle, I was 38, I was 19, 17 years old. And I wasn't sure that I was going to get paid, but about 3 or 4 weeks later, I got a check from town of Andover for 2 hours fighting fire. 12.5 cents an hour and 25 cents. And I still have that check somewhere today. I tried to find it. I tried to find it today to bring it. I often wondered how they ever kept the bookkeeper.
Love that 25 cents.
Okay.
Other stories? Is there any other stories?
Yeah. One occasion, a small group of us from Bates were taken into this. And I'm not positive where it was. It was somewhere in the brownfield area of Beaver Falls. But we were taken into this farmhouse, beautiful old farmhouse. It was completely surrounded by trees. I would say there's no more than an acre of cleared land, completely around it. And we were to help unload all we could onto this truck. Well, the truck wasn't much bigger than a pickup truck. But we managed to put everything on it. And the thing I remember so vividly was hearing the wind was blowing that night, and the pine trees were literally exploding. That roar you could hear, and I don't know how far away it was, but it was sure scary. And about the time the driver decided it was time to get out of there, he took off, and the rest of us were running, trying to jump and grab onto the truck so we could get out of there. Ironically, we went back the next morning, and guess what was still standing? That house.
The house.
But another thing that the film tells it all, but a few things I think of that wasn't covered in the film. People, after 2 or 3 days of these fires, they were dazed. I mean, there were rumors going around that the communists were setting the fires. And we'd go by in a bus and see these elderly, saw an elderly man. 2 different times we saw a person carrying a shotgun or a rifle walking along the highway. And one town, we were going through on a bus, and this young fellow had completely taken over the town, so it declared martial law. He says, "You're not going through, you're going to help us fight our fire right here." And the bus driver had quite a time talking him out of it and letting us go through. So it doesn't take much of a disaster like that to put people on the thin edge of sanity and insanity.
Right. Any other comments about the fire that we need to bring up?
I'd like to say something.
Yeah.
That was the week I moved to Bethel. And believe me, when you came into town on the 14th or 15th of June, the smoke was rolling right around. Now I'll never forget it because you can smell it so plainly, but it seemed like all summer long.
Yep.
because of the fact that in 1947, I can remember, as we lived in the vicinity of Deering High School, the smoke began coming up. And the, well, we'll say the town of Woodfords sent men with brooms. I was telling this story to someone and they said, what were those brooms for? Well, of course, that was when I was mentally alert, let me say. So I thought to myself, now what are those brooms for? And they were so, if the ashes came, Stan, it was as near as that. I have never forgotten it. And I could see the smoke coming in back of Deering High School and the flames coming up. And we were asked, did we want to leave? And most of us did. It was one experience that I couldn't believe.
Any other comments from the audience? Anybody got any other?
Stan, even the plumes of smoke were visible as you drove from Newry Corner toward Bethel. You could see these 5, 6, 7 huge plumes of smoke on the southern horizon.
Right.
It was a bad time.
I think one of the things any of us can really imagine, unless we were there, about how scared people were. The wildfire loose really emphasizes how terrifying the whole experience was for a lot of people, and I think that's something we would have trouble dealing with today, even today. And certainly those people who went through it have very vivid memories of that, the terror that these people felt, and they felt at the time. Anybody got anything else?
One more story.
Yeah,
Dan.
Yeah.
The last day we were there, they took us out to this good-sized apple orchard, and someone had come up with the bright idea of setting a backfire. Try, and that was one of the things that would work if you could get the right circumstances. But anyway, we worked at, in the meantime, it really looked like the owner thought he was going to lose his orchard. And he had it looked like a cemetery vault built right into the ground, a big cache of hard cider. And he started giving it away. He was sure he was going to lose everything. The deer were running through the orchard, and it was just. Well, we worked on the backfire, and by gosh, it worked. Once he realized he was going to save his orchard, he shut us off. We had our gallon jugs of hot cider to take back with us.
On that note, I think we should conclude this evening's oral history, and I'll turn it back to Walter.
Yeah, well, first I want to give a hearty thanks to the panel. And Sis, if you'd like to tell us about our refreshments for the evening.
Yeah. Well, thanks to you, dear Gwenda. You really introduced me. We're going to talk about a little bit about apples because this is the month for apples, October. We missed the first day of October, but I think you will be just as happy because that was Vegetable Day. And I don't know if you would enjoy just having vegetables for dessert. But apples were very special for many, many years. People liked apples and they did it. And they think that's why, that when we talk about the Bible, that they always say that Adam and Eve, that they ate an apple. Because it could just as well have been a banana. But they the Greeks talked about the golden apples, and it was the first, when the pilgrims came over to this country, they brought the apples with them. And at first they were very, very small apples, and then they finally got to be really good apples, as you know, and there's a sample on the table there. And they're so good that we have different expressions about apples, and one of them is that we talk about it just as apple. And an apple is just as American as an apple pie. And the first pies were very small, and then the apples grew bigger, and they made better pies and better pies. And then finally I got so, and one newspaper said that any country that was a pie-eating people like us would know nobody could ever stop him from being the most important country in the world. And we talk about an apple a day, and that started way back in England when they had, in the old English language, and they said that if you ate an apple, a gourd, before you went to bed, that it would make the doctor beg his bread. And then Johnny Appleseed, of course, was in this country, and he traveled out west and wearing a bag, just a bag, and a tin pan on his head, and he spread apple seeds all out through the west. His name, of course, was really Johnny Chapman. And then they talk about that he's somebody who's so great that he's an apple of his eye. And that came from the Greeks, because the Greeks and the English, and they had a word that meant the same thing as apple and eye together. It's odd because when you think about it, but it was called apple, and it meant the same thing as an eye or an apple. And so from that they got that you were the apple of his eye. And another thing that we talk about is the apple polishing. And then, and they said that a long time ago, when they had a little rural school, then the kids would say, "Hey, we polish up an apple and give the apple to the teacher. Then she won't know that we don't know our arithmetic." And then you talk about the Adam's apple. Well, I told you it could just as well have been the banana, but we always say it was an apple. And so the guy's got an apple, an Adam's apple, because he couldn't eat the apple. They eat it, but he couldn't eat it, and got stuck. And so, with that, we have some apples for you to dip tonight, and also some chocolate cake, and some apple cake, and some cider, and I guess that's that.
Can I make a comment on how to get what's the problem? Remember back, I want to say, late 1950s, early 1960s, some weekly magazine here in Maine published an article on old varieties of apples, and they happened to make the comment that in a certain year back, come on, he said there'd been something like 2 million varieties of apples grown in Maine, and people that wrote articles later than that said, well, he must have been drinking some of his own apples. There were never 2 million varieties of apples.